All right, ladies and gentlemen, back into the artwork again. Clearly, since the last video, I've worked on this considerably more, but you don't want to watch how long it actually takes to produce these pieces any more than I want to show them to you. So I'm going to continue to build the piece. I've had some time to think on it. I had been cleaning the studio. I'll share those videos later, but you know, I'm at a stopping point there because I need some new storage. That's for another day. So I want to work back into the figures right now. I've laid in some of the background area. And that's one of the things you need to do when you're working is work to develop your whole piece at once. There is, like I just said, I said background, but there's really no part of your painting that is more or less important than another. It's all about image, surface, texture, but it's about the paint on the paper or on whatever substrate you're using, canvas, paper, whatever it may be. So each area should come up, be developed together simultaneously so that you're not painting in a background, as it were, that the whole painting is a single unit of integrity, of importance. And that's part of having fingers. Sometimes you have to do that. I need to know where I am. In the painting, there's this one painting that a collector has, and he says one of the things that he loves about the artwork, that the particular painting, is that in that one painting there is the absolute best hand that I've ever done and the absolute worst. And that's part of the reason why he likes the artwork, is because it possesses both of those extremes. My father once told me, my father was a mathematician, but not an artist at all. I don't come from a family of artists. And he said, one of his pieces of advice, he had two very good ones about the business of being an artist. These two were, never asked them why they like the painting. You may find out it's because it goes with the drapes. And I've had that happen. Not my favorite reason for somebody to love my art by far. But that is why some people buy art. They consider it decoration. There's ever seen Hannah and Her Sisters, one of the caricatures as an artist. He gets all irate because the person who comes to buy art is looking for something puce. I mean, it was a color. It just gets very irritating. Because we like to think, all of us, that our art means something. I hope this painting ends up meaning something. This is not a painting, I don't think, that anyone is going to buy because it goes with the wallpaper. First off, it's a pretty crazy wallpaper. But it's just, most of my art is not something that will blend into the background, blend into the furniture. It tends to be a little more aggressive than that. think I'm coming up a finger short. And there's part of me that doesn't care. I'm gonna let it slide. Oh, and to get back to the point I was making earlier, another thing my father said, and this is kind of applies to everything you're trying to sell, it's only worth what you can sell it for when you need the money. Which at the time that he told me that many years ago, I didn't grasp. No, it's worth what I say it's worth, or it's worth this much money. And he's like, no, because really, it's just a number until you need to turn it into cash. And once you need to turn it into cash, the number is what somebody would give you for. So it's not. It may feel a little cruel, but it's not inaccurate. So, that leads me to another point. Which I probably forgot. That leads me to another point. I have, in some circles, been criticized because if you look at my larger work and my website, gregleach.com, you'll find a lot of bar scene kind of paintings. And that's because I work outside of the studio as well. Not only do I do this, and this is what I consider my day job, I have a second job working as a bartender. And part of that is the lesson learned from my father. And over time, I've had it reiterated that if you're only counting on the studio for your income, then, you know, others have hit a point in their lives where they can do that, and I don't do bad, but I've learned not to be in the position of having to really discover what my father meant about it's only worth what you can sell it for when you need the money. If you're avoid being in the situation of having to get some money out of your artwork at a particular time, if you're not needing the money and all you have to sell is artwork, and I've been in this situation before, you'll find that you'll sell the artwork for whatever you can get for it. So if you need $1,500 and you have a painting that on the website is $5,000, you need that money and you need that $1,500 now, that's what you're going to sell it for. So, several reasons, one being I don't want to be in that situation of desperately trying to sell artwork. And to be fair to people who've paid what I think is the right fair price for my artwork, fair to me and still fair to me. I know it's crass to talk about art and money, but this is what we're doing. This is our skill. This is what we studied in school. You know? Nobody worries about a dentist setting his particular prices. And those prices are based on experience education and knowledge, why would it be any different for an artist? And then, of course, I'm sure many of you have experienced the, oh, but think of the exposure you'll get. Which is never said to a dentist or a plumber. So, this I'm sort of hitting a two-edged point of value what you do. Emotions sense, but also value what you do in an economic sense. So I'm just working through this piece. So I've got the hands on now. I want to lay in the figure here, sort of real part of the real focus of this piece. Because this is going to be a large block of these green tones, and you need to build and balance a painting. So you need to know how your colors in your work are relating. How's the painting building in terms of an interrelationship of color? Which also goes back to that idea I was talking about initially, about building the painting all at once. Because a painting is, color is, a painting is, the relationship of all the colors, of all the image, of all the shape around it. So, if I were to get one area completely finished and then start on another, the quality of color might shift. What I think is perfect color here, but I put something over there, they don't balance, they don't work together. And I'm back in here changing this one, and then I'm back over there. So I try to build the whole painting together. So you get a sense, I get a sense, I know where I'm going. That's fair, I know where you're going, I'm going. The way I work. I mean, clearly I had an idea, a subject matter, a moment in time that I was trying to talk about. Because, yeah, I think paintings are conversations. They're a conversation between the viewer and the artist. And like all conversations, it can easily end up that what I'm trying to say is not what's being heard. Or, if I'm really lucky, I'm saying more than I thought I was. I'm hoping this painting fits into that category. That'll ultimately be up to you guys. So you can see the paint sticks. I'm building one color back and forth on top of each other. And that's how I'm getting these values and textures. And before we're done here, with all this video, the videos of this painting happening, I will give you close-ups so you can get a better idea of just how this is all happening. So, I stop in mid-sentence because I'm trying to think at the same time that I'm talking to you. try it. Figure out just where the hell I'm going. Because I'm pretty sure I said it at the start in the previous video of this painting. There's not a preliminary sketch to this thing. I haven't solved problems. I haven't figured all the ins and outs. And that's a personal preference, and I'm not belittling anybody who works that way, or they sketch it all out. Very, very good friend, excellent painter, Andros Balady. You can find him, I know, on Instagram. And he always does small sketches, and usually is out doing those plein air, little 12 by 14, 12 by 16 images. I'm lucky enough to own one of those. And then he uses those, and then maybe a couple of different small paintings, but he uses those small paintings as the source material to build his big ones. But that's just not the way I work. That's not what works for me. I like to make all the discoveries in the painting, see, and when I look at paintings, I love to see how the artists got where they got. If that makes sense to you. You know, what changes were made, what ideas were followed and then surrendered. So I try to show a little bit of that evidence, a little bit of those ideas that shifted. So, I will remind you all that I'm working with Shiva Paintstiks. I'll put a link to their website. They're the brand that I just have always enjoyed. There are other brands out there. Winter Newton makes one. Holbein makes one. But for me, these are that perfect balance of binder and pigment, and opacity and translucency as well. So when you make changes and corrections, one of the things you run into is an opacity factor. And sometimes you can use that as underpainting. You can use that to help inform where the work is going. Sometimes it can be a very frustrating disaster. So, nevertheless, so these are the my medium, my paint stick of choice. And one of the reasons I settled on paint sticks, a couple. One is because I'm really interested in color and the interaction of color. It really helps you use the paint stick because all of the mixing, all of the colors are created where they're going to be, so you get that conversation of color, what I was talking about before, about finishing color and then laying something else. What's here changes the quality of that color. So by mixing everything right where it goes, I have more control. So if you're working with paint, and I did just post a video earlier today of doing some acrylic painting on a mural piece, editing the mural. I back to that subject matter of that. Those figures a little bit into this. But, so you're mixing paint on a palette, and that color is informed by the colors around on the palette, but they may not be the colors you're going to go that will be next to the where you actually put that color you just mixed. So I find these to allow me more control over what's happening dramatically. And therefore, able to make a more chromatically balanced paint. And I'll get in more into that as we move forward on this artwork. Alright, so I'm going to stop the video here because I'm trying to keep these fairly short. Hopefully keep your interest. But again, my artwork is at gregleach.com, GREIGLEACH.com. The paint sticks are from Richson Art. This is what the exterior of the packaging looks like. Obviously it's backwards, but yeah. And there, RICHESONART.com. Hopefully you like these. Hopefully you'll give me some comments. Give me some feedback. Let me know what else you need to know. Obviously a like and a follow if it's your first visit would be deeply appreciated. Thanks for taking the time to watch.